How do you get to go to the next slide? Got her? Okay. So this is the gyre that we're talking about. Remember the book talked about our garbage patches? The thing I want to point out, though, is that when I read the book, I got the impression they were talking about this massive pile of debris out there. Well, that's not how it works. Matter of fact, if you drove through what would be the garbage patch with your ship, it's very likely you would never see a thing, even though we call it the garbage patch. So this mental picture that you get from the book as to a garbage patch is not the reality. So what is going on here? Well, stuff like this can be there. Leftover traps and other debris, some of which can fall screws of ships. Lots of nets that get away from the various ships and stuff that are out there, the trawlers and stuff. Once the net gets away from the ship, it still keeps catching fish. And these are called ghost fish, because they get caught, and all that's left of them is their ghosts. And so that's what they're referred to as. And of course, it's always a horrible sight. And the other problem is a lot of this net stuff is just below the surface, floating around. A lot of this stuff isn't on the surface. And then, of course, there are plastics out there. This happens to be an albatross. You can see that it ingested plastic until it could no longer survive. The plastic took over its digestive system. So that goes on. But the real problem is this. This is the garbage patch. This is what the garbage patch is. Microscopic size debris about the size of plankton. And as a matter of fact, in the garbage patches, the broken down plastic, because when plastic breaks down, it breaks down into smaller and smaller chunks. And it works its way into becoming microscopic, about the size of plankton. And so in the places where we talked about the garbage patches, this is the garbage. The plastic that's broken down so that there's more plastic than there is plankton to eat. That's the problem. That's the problem that exists out there. Okay, so plastic is the enemy. Plastic breaks down into this stuff. And we don't even have a clue yet what the effect of that on the ecosystem is going to be. We don't even have an idea. We have no idea yet. And then the last one I wanted to do, I wanted to point out it's almost impossible for the Hello Kitty lunchbox to get to Whale Town, which is up at the end of the Georgia Strait. The reason I say that is because the Puget Sound is a ford estuary. In a ford estuary, you have lots of fresh water, which is less dense than the seawater. And when you have a location like the Puget Sound, we have all that fresh water flowing out of the Cascades and the Olympic Mountains. Okay, you have all that flowing into the Puget Sound. Well, it goes out on the surface. It leaves Puget Sound on the surface. When the tides come in, they actually undercut the fresh water. And in the Puget Sound, there's actually a couple sills just like this. There's one at the entrance to the Puget Sound, there's one going up in the Georgia Strait, and another one going down in the Puget Sound itself, which is uplifted areas. But the general flow of the Puget Sound is out to sea, not into the Puget Sound and up the Straits of Georgia. There are some times a year when you get a little bit more likely to have flow, but if you look at where they're monitoring for the tsunami debris, they're not monitoring for it in the Puget Sound. They're monitoring for it at the entrance to the Straits of Juan de Fuca. Okay, so the chances, when it comes to science, I never say never. Okay, I always think anything's possible. But I'd be a pretty big skeptic that lunchbox made it up there. But I thought it was a wonderful way to introduce the way the book was presented. What better way was there to get it started to tell the story. Anyhow, that's what I wanted. That's caught my. Those are the things that caught my eye when I was reading the book, among others. Okay, so that's all I had.
Let's put you up there, and then we'll have everybody ask questions about it. Okay.
Want to interrupt me?
So I asked Joe, we're not going to get any tsunamis here, but what are we worried about here? What are our weather issues, our concerns when we live in this very contained, un-oceanic environment?
What are our weather threats here in Western Colorado?
Wildfires. Flooding.
Floods. Yeah, drought and floods, same thing, just different.
Mm-hmm. Earthquakes.
And blizzards, something we're going to see in the next couple days. Mm-hmm. Friday morning, we may wake up to an inch or three here in the valley.
We drive a lot better than they do in Atlanta, though.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, it's snow. You can't drive anywhere.
It was ice.
It was
ice.
It was ice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Avalanche.
Avalanches, yep. Yep, that's certainly weather related.
So, yes, what do you make of the avalanche that just came down on Red Mountain Pass?
Oh, that was a rock fall. Yeah. Yeah, it was.
But is that weather related?
Well, one of the cool aspects of water is that it, as it turns to solid, it expands so that the rock, you know, rock faces like that go through, ever going through freeze thaw, basically get, you know, jackhammered a little bit just with every freeze thaw. The water works down into cracks, then overnight or, you know, during a cold period, it freezes and expands and pushes on the rock, and you get rock falls. It's part of living in paradise here, I guess.
So now what happens? What do they have to do to, how much research will they have to do to make sure it's safe to?
It's still closed, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
For the foreseeable future. I have a mother, elderly mother in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I was going down to see during these days off. I'm not going back. So.
Is that a result of
that man-made? Is that a result of the highway being put through there or not?
Rock falls are natural process.
It didn't happen anywhere, but in that particular case, yeah, I wondered about that.
Put $1 million highway through a narrow vertical canyon, you're going to have some problems.
Like that.
So man-made because we're there, happens everywhere.
I wanted to ask some questions, if I could, about the West Coast, and I don't know if that's what you're also studying and monitoring at all, but when you were talking about monitoring for ocean debris and why you wouldn't be doing it in a place where so much water is just going up, where would you be monitoring, or where are they monitoring, say, on the Oregon coast for ocean debris? Would it be between headlands? Would it be between, like, a mountain headland or shallow harbors, or...
The debris would get driven toward, if there's a headland, the debris gets driven toward headland, so you would put your monitoring station.
Right.
Most likely where it would get driven into. What happens is, if you have a headland, when you have a bay, like along the Oregon coast, it's because the energy of the ocean has gotten directed towards the headland, and so that allows you to have that quiet, sandy little bay on each side of those headlands. So you, if you wanted to find debris, you'd go look, you'd look where it was driven ashore at the headland. So I'm sure that's where they put the water station. There's a website, I think it's a NOAA website, Ocean Debris, I think, if you want to look it up. But it also shows where the monitoring stations all up and down the West Coast are.
I'm wondering, too, I just wanted to ask another question. I'm working in a book that takes place actually on the Oregon coast, so I was really interested in the tsunamis and the fact that we have an author who's also trying to alert us to what's going on in the world. So I've been studying and talking to oceanographers for a couple of years now. The last one I talked to was really, really, I mean, the biggest chagrin really was about the changing pH level of the ocean. And I was wondering if that was something that you look at or are concerned about, or if there are other bigger indicators.
Well, increasing pH of the ocean is caused by the extra carbon dioxide being absorbed. Our carbon dioxide level is rising. Carbon dioxide level is rising, and so if the carbon dioxide level is rising, the ocean is going to absorb more of that energy. Now, one of the problems with the ocean temperature is increasing is that solubility of the gases into the ocean increases with decreasing temperatures. So with the ocean temperature warming to some extent, that also drives some of the gases out of the ocean. So, but the net result is we have more near surface CO2 that's being absorbed in the ocean, and then there's a process that it goes through and you end up with carbonic gas. So yeah, the ocean acidity is increasing.
But that also, for example, isn't that also affecting the marine life a lot in the ocean?
Corals
especially.
Corals
especially.
What about all the starfish? They just recently found in California.
I'd be more worried about the tsunami that's coming on the Washington Oregon coast.